gradually transitioning into late fall. We've had one good push of cold air come down into the southern U.S. and more cold air flowing south into the Great Lakes. Speaking of the Great Lakes, on this date in 1975, the Edmund Fitzgerald went down in Lake Superior. This is a weather chart for the day before, November 9th of 75. An active Great Plains weather system, baroclinic low, dew points in the 60s flowing north into Kansas and Missouri, and up to the north some rather cold air, and gets down into the 20s as you go into Manitoba and Ontario. The next day, a significant weather system in the Great Lakes, rapid deepening as that low pulled out of Kansas. 982 millibar low across Lake Superior. The sinking was right there later in the day as this very strong gradient whipped around the south side of that low. Now the triple point is located right there. You can see the warm front extending off to the east. So most of the strong baroclinicity is moving on off to the east, but lots of trailing dynamics back there to the west, and this can be a potent area for blizzards if you get those temperatures down a little bit cooler. In this case, early November, temperatures are in the 30s, so not much of that, although they did have snow squalls across parts of Lake Superior, and those winds did pick up to 30 to 40 knots, possibly even stronger. So there's the reconstructed conditions on Lake Superior. 40 knot winds and seas up to 25 to 30 feet. And there's the sinking location. And we compare that with conditions today, much calmer out there on the lakes. Who was Edmund Fitzgerald? A little bit of trivia for you. It was named after the 1950s era president and chairman of the board of Northwestern Mutual. Maybe a little bit narcissistic for him to have that ship named after him, but Edmund's family had all been Great Lakes captains, and Edmund himself tried to veto the idea, but he was overruled by the board after he left the room. And the ship was christened in 1958, and so it goes. Edmund passed away in 1986 at the age of 90. All right, let's move on. The surface map for this afternoon showing a 1024 millibar polar high from North Dakota down to Oklahoma and Texas. Northerly flow coming down towards the western Gulf region. Rain from Shreveport to Houston and back into the Davis Mountains. In Lake Superior, well, there is a cold northerly flow, but winds are limited to about 10 knots. The northeastern U.S. underneath cold air advection. Let's take a look at the satellite imagery. And we see a definite cold air advection pattern across Michigan and Ontario. Large convective elements north of London, Ontario, back into the Detroit area. And this has the appearance of a shortwave dropping south, kind of a S shape on the back of that cloud field. And you can just barely see that on the water vapor imagery, maybe a cyclonic vorticity max right there, and a shortwave extending south. And this is the area of upper level lift just ahead of that. Does that show up on the 500 millibar heights and vorticity? It appears we do. There is some cyclonic curvature in the wind field right there around Chicago just a couple of hours ago, and that is propagating very rapidly eastward in the flow, although the flow is dominated by channeled jet energy. So most of the cyclonic vorticity aligned parallel to the wind flow. Further to the east, mountain wave activity from New York over to Vermont and Maine. In parts of New York, it does appear there's maybe some neutral to warm advection right through there, but up to the north, this is all strong cold advection. So this is up at about 30,000 feet. This is definitely a lot of jet stream energy, especially across Maine and Nova Scotia, up to 150 to 160 knots. down in the southern U.S., it does drop off to about 50 to 60 knots. And we can tie that in with the low-level situation. This is going to be the front's thickness and pressure, the red bands indicating thermal gradient. So pretty strong right there through the northeastern U.S., supporting that strong jet stream energy. And the jet stream energy a little bit weaker down to the south, but enough to support a couple of separate bands right there and another one in the northern plains. So as we mentioned, that cold air pushing pretty far to the south, even through Brownsville and Monterey. It is having quite an impact on weather in Mexico, upslope flow, and frontal lift all the way through the Sierra Madre Oriental, and back into the El Paso area where we've got clouds and rainy weather. That's a look at Van Horn in the Davis Mountains of West Texas, and there's El Paso this afternoon. And a little bit further north, that is Lake Mescalero in the mountains between Alamogordo and Roswell, surrounded by some very warm regions during the warm season. Not much to talk about in the northern U.S. underneath the influence of this large high. In the southwestern U.S., not very much going on in that area either. But as we go out to the northwestern U.S., some developing weather problems up there for this weekend. Still, a lot of fog trapped in the interior valleys of Washington. Ellensburg was under a freezing fog advisory this morning. At last check, they were coming up above 32 degrees. We are looking at another atmospheric river approaching the northwestern U.S. that'll be making landfall tomorrow morning and moving into Washington and Oregon during the day. Flood watches in effect for parts of western Washington for this weekend, and gale warnings posted for Puget Sound. We have a high wind watch for southeastern Wyoming for tomorrow. That's going to be around Interstate 80 west of Cheyenne. And a high wind warning for tomorrow for the Montana foothills, including Great Falls, Lewiston, Cut Bank, all that affected. And here's how it unfolds. Major Pacific system offshore, warm front like that, cold front further to the west, and there's our occlusion. Tomorrow morning, we see that cold front making its way towards the coast, and that's going to bring a big change for Seattle, Tacoma. As that passes through, you can see the rain really pick it up, and that cold front rapidly moves inland, and the weather goes downhill in the Bitterroots for later Saturday. The gradients are really picking up. That's when we're going to see those really gusty winds around Great Falls, and unsettled weather continuing further to the west. And that'll move into the northern plains for Sunday. Alaska is going to be dealing with problems of their own. You can see cold air advection, well, rather weak cold advection across the Bering Sea. There's that Gulf of Alaska system, but as we go into the weekend, this is when things really pick up. You see that area of warm advection out there south of Anadyr, Russia? Chukotka. That's that large area of warm air advection. That's going to be spreading into western Alaska towards Sunday. There it is. And let me give you the frontal positions. That's going to be the cold front. There's the warm front and then the occlusion. So this is a very potent weather system in Russia, having effects all the way into Nome, Kotzebue, and Bethel. So there are winter storm watches posted across a large area of western Alaska for later in the weekend. See, there's that precip picking up Sunday night and into Monday. So this will have big effects on Alaska going into early next week. For the time being, though, it's pretty good. Temperatures in the 20s and 30s for the most part. And then out there in Canada, that's where the truly cold Arctic area is. Coldest temperature is 26 degrees at Eureka, and looks like we have, yeah, that's going to be it for cold weather. Looks like minus 17 in northern Banks Island. Central Canada looking pretty good. You can see that prevailing southwesterly flow. That's kind of a warm pattern for them. And they get the benefit of downslope warming in places like Alberta, northeastern British Columbia, and Saskatchewan. And that has effects all the way down into Montana. So temperatures are coming up into the 30s and 40s along the lee side of the Rockies. Pretty quiet out in the tropics, though the seven-day outlook is focusing on the Caribbean just east of Nicaragua. So is that anything to be concerned about? Well, we're focusing on that region right there. The area mostly dominated by this dumping zone of frontal boundaries out into the Gulf of Mexico and the Gulf Stream region. So we go into Saturday and Sunday and into Monday and Tuesday. This little band of red, this is just friction along the coastline. Don't need to worry about that. This could be something that's part of the intertropical convergence zone and a little area of cyclogenesis right there south of Texas, maybe picking up on that baroclinic boundary out there south of Houston. So it looks like now we're picking up a system there. This is going to be about Tuesday next week, east of Nicaragua. And that comes together, get a closed low, maybe 999 millibars there. Meanwhile, low pressure area south of New Orleans, so maybe a little extra tropical frontal system there in the Gulf. Anyway, we got that closed low down to 986, 978 millibars drifting north across Cuba. And the forecast gets a little bit more unreliable as we get further out into the future. So by mid-November, maybe something passing through the Bahamas, Cuba, Haiti, Dominican Republic, but mostly just kind of loitering and drifting to the northeast. So nothing really to be concerned about here in the U.S. So let's take a look at our short-range forecast. That's where we're at right now. Let's go into tomorrow afternoon. So we see the weather systems move. Still unsettled along the Gulf Coast. This is going to be that large area of frontal lift. And the polar high continues pushing south into Mexico. So that'll have effects mostly down south near our southern neighbor. Going into Sunday, also looks fairly quiet, although one little wave coming out of Mexico. So it looks like the precip picking back up there in Texas and spreading north a little bit. And that's the very last frame that we have there for Monday. So a continuation of the unsettled weather in Texas. Let's take a look at the 500 millibar heights and vorticity. So this is where we're at right now, but you can see this troughiness in the southwestern U.S. And then going into the overnight hours and into tomorrow, we get a low shearing off in the Gulf of California. So that is our wild card for this weekend. And as it drifts to the east, it interacts with that frontal zone, and we get the formation of a stable wave along the front, probably an increase in the isentropic lift across Texas, helping to spread some of that precip into the state, maybe as far north as Dallas. And then it continues migrating to the east, closed low right there for midday Tuesday, and then drifting east along the Gulf Coast, opening up and breaking up into a couple of troughs like that. And you can see that things are definitely getting active along the West Coast. Very large long wave trough and a couple of smaller scale systems. This closed low off of California and another closed low across British Columbia. So I think we are looking at some very active weather out in the western U.S. for next week. And that's all for this edition of Forecast Lab. I want to thank a couple of our newest Patreon supporters, William Reed, and also Elizabeth Darden and Chris Jackson. Thank you very much for your support of this program. And in our closing credits, a listing of people who have helped us. Many are financial supporters, but others have been important contributors in other ways or have helped get the word out. Either way, I appreciate you all for being here and helping to keep the program going. Hope you have a great weekend. Take care, and we'll see you back here Monday for the supporters and on Wednesday for everybody else. Hope you have a good Friday night, and we'll see you soon. Bye-bye.